as I tweeted last night, as soon as I finished the movie, the Oscar season is off and running with this film. And what a jump start with Five Bloods. I'm really impressed. And they're already starting their Oscar campaign, by the way. As a Critics' Choice member, I vote in the Critics' Choice Awards, which is part of the whole awards season. I've already been invited on Wednesday to a digital event, you know, a virtual event, to listen to Spike Lee and some of the actors from the film talk about it. And I can't wait, because this is such a great movie. Try to avoid spoilers going in. There are so many fabulous twists and turns. And I'm not going to give anything away here, but I was really impressed with the movie's ability. I'm impressed with this movie in every way you can be impressed with a film. But one of the ways is its ability to surprise me. All right, so obviously, I feel this is Spike Lee's best film to date. He's always been, of course, a very passionate filmmaker with a distinct voice. Always been well known. But I think with this film, he truly becomes a cinematic auteur. And it's interesting to me. I feel like he's made a couple of films that haven't really been about the black experience. But for the most part, that's been the focus of most of his work. And of course here, you know, this is very much, you know, focusing on, black characters. But just like this movie itself rises above that and is also just a movie about four guys, I think Spike Lee rises above maybe, you know, I think Black Klansman was a first step as well in this direction. But to just being, you know, a filmmaker that's just telling stories. I mean, that aspect is still there, but I think he levels up to being a filmmaker, you know, at the level, at the highest levels that could make anything. I'm really impressed with this work. So when Five Bloods started, I felt it was a lot like Black Klansman. Which was fine by me, because I loved that movie. So I was like, okay, he's going to basically do the same thing here. A lot of using real pictures, real footage. And I think that's great. I love seeing the real people. You'll learn a lot watching this movie, just like you did with Black Klansman. But as this movie progressed, Five Bloods, I also saw the influence of two other movies. Apocalypse Now, which Lee says was very influential in shaping him as a filmmaker. And also The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, which Lee says is his favorite film. I've seen both those movies. I have to say, I feel this film is better than both those films and more commercial. This is a very commercial film. And on that note, side note, before we get to my next point, please read his recent interview with The Hollywood Reporter, which not only offers terrific insight into the making of this film, I can't believe no studio would make this movie. That's horrible and shows a very important need in the industry that Netflix is filling. Because this movie, it would be horrible if it had never been made. It's fantastic. But also the interview sheds some insight as to Lee, not only as a filmmaker, but also a producer, working his way through the Hollywood system. And it shows how savvy he is. He's very, very talented, very smart individual. I've put a link to that interview in the comments down below. I've pinned it to the top. All right, so anyway, back to this. So the movie, and on the note of it being more mainstream and more commercial, as it went further along, and it's 2.5 hours, so it's a long journey, but worth every second, it finally came to me that Five Bloods reminds me the most of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Now, I had some problems with Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, as many of you know, but it was only with content, what the film was saying and how it was saying it. I think, I said in my review, it was of that film, it's an incredibly well-made movie with incredible performances. So if you take out the problematic stuff and you just leave the good stuff, you have Five Bloods. Maybe some of you will have, you know, a different experience. Maybe your experience watching this will be more like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood for me. But honestly, anyone could be offended with anything in this movie. I felt there were no lies told. By the way, they had Hanoi Hannah, I believe. I forgot to put her in my notes, so I'll mention her now while I'm thinking of it. That was some amazing scenes. And the actress that they cast in the role nailed it. Really, really compelling stuff. I loved it. So how is it like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood? Well, there's the running time, incredibly long. It explores a specific time period, which is still relevant to many people living today. But it adds genre elements to make it more accessible as entertainment. Here, buried treasure. It's absurd. And it has shocking story developments where you're like, I can't believe that just happened. Like, there's one scene where I'm like, holy crap. There are actually multiple scenes where I was like, oh my God, they went there and it was amazing. And also the third act goes off, I don't want to give anything away, but it's explosive. And also stunning visuals that are very carefully crafted. I'm talking not only set and costume design, but camera placement and movement. As I said, Spike Lee is totally in control. He is an auteur. And also like a Tarantino movie, this film goes from funny to very serious and back again with the flip of a switch. And there is a lot of dialogue. It's not quite like Tarantino's dialogue is almost like surreal and a little meta. This is more organic, I'm not saying that Spike Lee took Tarantino's style. I'm just saying he definitely borrowed a few pages from Tarantino's playbook and added in some pages from Francis Ford Coppola's and John Huston's, as well as the very distinct style that he developed working on Black Klansman. And altogether, he's created something that's very much him, but allows him to stand, I think, as a filmmaker alongside those other incredible filmmakers. I mean, I don't think Spike Lee has ever made a movie that has the epic quality of, like, The Godfather. And this does! Oh, it's amazing. This film is perfect. This film is absolutely perfect. Now, if you read that interview that I told you to check out, you'll see that this script was originally written for 4 white characters. And it was brought to Lee because the producer, who was trying to get it off the ground, knew how much he'd like The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, and there are definite parallels. So Lee was like, I do love this. And so he and his frequent collaborator, writer Kevin Wilmot, rewrote the script to focus on a platoon of black soldiers. So the result is a film which has one foot in very political discussion, exploring what it meant and still means to be black soldiers fighting for America. In this case, in Vietnam, during the civil rights movement. What a crazy situation to be in. You don't even realize how weird that must have been until you see it explained here. It's powerful stuff, really good. And by the way, Lee shows how one of these men, played by Delroy Lindo, has gone on in life to become a Trump supporter. That's a major point and through line in the script. Because Lee, in that interview that I'm telling you about, he points out that 8% of African Americans did vote for Trump. And Lee wants to make it clear that black people, like any group, are not all the same. They're not a homogenous group. And I think that's a great choice. And I'd also like to add that Lindo's character isn't a caricature. Real effort is made into exploring why his character has gone down the path that he has, driven by pain, loss, guilt, anger, and a feeling of the whole world being, you know, against him. It's an extremely moving and complex portrait, and I think that a lot of people from other demographics who are Trump supporters will see some of their own story, I think, reflected there. I think it's very fair. But it's also a story on the flip side of just 4 guys who come back together after decades apart and go in search of buried treasure in an unforgiving wild environment which has haunted them because of their past experiences there. That's not set to any specific demographic or race or gender. It's just a really cool story. And I have to say that it is moving and really exciting to see it told with these characters. As a female viewer, I was like, let's do one with women. I'd love to see women in this kind of an adventure story. It's just really phenomenal. It's great. And so they go in search of this buried treasure. And as Humphrey Bogart will tell you in The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, and as one character tells another here in Five Bloods, when gold is in the mix, a lot of gold, things can get a bit crazy. And crazy they do get. Throughout the film, I had to watch through my fingers because I was so scared for the characters. I think that Spike Lee does an amazing job ratcheting up the tension and suspense of what's going to happen. It's very scary, very scary. Now, in addition to a very clever script, which covers an incredible amount of ground, they need that 2.5 hours, the film is, again, visually stunning. It's gorgeous. Lee intentionally chose cinematographer Newton Thomas Sigel, who in addition to shooting many big budget blockbusters, has also filmed multiple documentaries. And you really get a feel for the environment. They shot on location in Thailand and Vietnam. And it's fascinating, by the way, to see modern Vietnam and its people. They have a nightclub that's actually called Apocalypse Now. It's so cool. I mean, the film it's a slow burn at the beginning, but that's because Spike Lee's taking you on a journey, and it's a journey you really must go, you really need to go on. It's great. But the film is stunning, and almost every single frame could be put on a wall in a frame. And I love that when movies do that. It's just really great. Now, of course, none of this matters if you don't have characters that you care about, and you really care about these characters. The cast is very strong across the board. There isn't a weak link, and it's diverse, with not only Johnny Tree, Nguyen's local guide, but also a group of landmine scouts, which includes Paul Walter Hauser, working with Lee again after Black Klansman. Paul Walter Hauser is a very, very good actor. I recently watched the Richard Jewell movie that Clint Eastwood did with him, and where he was a lead. he did a really nice job. But the real standouts in this movie, here Paul Walter has a very small role, but the real standouts here are Delroy Lindo. He has, I think, the awards caliber role in the film. And I'll be curious, since he is playing a Trump supporter, if he's in the running. But he gives a very brave, raw performance, and what a character arc. I mean, he's not a happy person. He's being, I don't want to give anything away, but, you know, I think it shows sometimes bad choices are a reflection of pain inside and lashing out. And I think that's really interesting to explore. Jonathan Majors, as his son, I've been singing Jonathan Majors' praises for some time now. I feel like he is on the cusp of stardom. He's right there. And he is, of course, phenomenal in this movie. I'm such a big Jonathan Majors fan. I love his work. The Trump stuff is tough. I think it's important for me to point out, especially as we're heading towards an election, that I am not in favor of Trump, but I want to be respectful. It's a landmine that Spike Lee has put in his movie, but I think it's a very brave thing to do, and I think he doesn't do it cheaply. I guess that's how I'll say it. I think that Delroy Lindo is a character that, even if you don't agree, like myself, with his choices that he's made, you understand him and you care about him. And I think that's good stuff. All right, so anyway, Clark Peters does a wonderful job. As to me, not only the brains of the group, but I felt the heart. He plays just a wonderful, real person, and I personally gravitated towards him the most. I really loved his character very much. And then, of course, Chadwick Boseman, right? He has a very small role, but he makes a very big impression, as he's supposed to. Jean Reno also makes a big impression, but I'm not going to give anything away. Earlier in the film, he and Delroy Lindo have a very funny and interesting conversation about World War II. I thought it was really well done and very well written. Some important notes. Since the film covers a lot of ground and has extensive flashbacks, the way you can tell what era you're in is by the aspect ratio. And the movie is very clear about when it's changing the aspect ratio. But in case you miss it, I just want to make sure that you look for that. Also, what might confuse some people off the bat is that Lindo, Peters, Norm Lewis, and Isaiah Whitlock Jr. play themselves back in Vietnam, but at their current age. They don't use younger actors or de-aging technology or prosthetics. Spike Lee explains in that interview that it just wasn't plausible, both practically and from a budget perspective. And at first it's a little jarring, but I have to say, I think ultimately it was a really great choice because it underscored how their fallen commander, Chadwick Boseman, and that's not a spoiler, you can find that out immediately in the movie, is a ghost among them, and that he's still a young man when they remember their days back in Vietnam, who never got to grow old like the rest of them. I cried a lot during this movie. I'm not going to tell you when, because I said I don't want to give you any spoilers, but I cried a lot. It was very moving, but I also laughed, and I marveled at the whole damn thing. Very, very good. So that's my review. That's my review of The Five Bloods. I'm very curious to hear your thoughts about it. If you want to put a spoiler comment, make sure you mark it as such, because again, we don't want to ruin the experience for anybody. I really hope that you watch it. Spike Lee was very responsible. He said he didn't think that anyone should go to the movies right now, so he's glad that people can see this at home, and hopefully they'll give it a shot, you know, even if, you know, he hopes more people maybe will see it because they want to see something new. And really, it's an Oscar-caliber film. It's definitely something you should watch. And it still feels that way even on a smaller screen because it's just so well made. All right, so again, that's my review. Share those thoughts down below. Subscribe today. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.